Board of Trustees, remind you all again, we're streaming live on video and audio, so please speak clearly into the mic and et cetera. I was remiss when we first gathered to not also take a moment while it was to see a sad departure of our friend Steve Glazier. It's also a happy day that we are welcoming a new colleague in Maggie White, who was recently appointed by Governor Brown to serve as our new student trustee. Maggie attends Cal State Stanislaus, where she majors in communication studies and economics, both interests that this board will look to her talents for, so thank you. Maggie, on behalf of all of my colleagues, I want to welcome you to the board and thank you in advance for your continued service to the CSU, so welcome. Trustee Garcia, will you now please convene the Committee on Audit?
Thank you, Chair Monville. This meeting of the Committee of Audit is called order. First thing, unless there are any changes to the minutes of the meeting of May 19th, 2015, this consent item is approved. So we have one agenda item, which is an information item. It's the status report on the current and follow-up internal audit assignments. Vice Chancellor and Chief Audit Officer Larry Mendel will present the item and respond to any questions that you may have. Larry?
Thank you, Chair Garcia. Item one in your agenda includes both a status on the 2015 audit plan and follow-up on past assignments. In your packet is an updated attachment A for the status report that shows progress since the agenda mailout. Those numbers and letters in green reflect the updates from the mailout. The left-hand side of the first page indicates progress to date on the 2015 audit plan, which was approved at the January board meeting. A majority of the 2015 audit assignments are currently in process. The remaining scholarships and student activities will be initiated in the coming months. The right-hand side of the first page and all the second page indicate progress made toward completion of recommendations. The campuses and Chancellor's office continue to do a good job completing recommendations on a timely basis. We only have one that's been outstanding for any period of time. I'm told that it's due to the needs for a meet and confer and that it'll be approved, it should be approved or taken care of by the next board meeting. The third page gives a status report on our reviews of construction projects for 2015. Both the reviews and associated recommendations are being completed timely. If you have any questions on the status report, we'll take them at this time.
No question. Larry, I just had one question. So you said there's one item that is a bit behind. Is that the one for?
That's the one at Stanislaus.
Stanislaus. Okay. Thank
you. On sponsored programs.
On sponsored programs. Thank you. Okay. And any other comments, questions? Larry, thank you for your report. And thank you again to the campuses for continuing to move these items forward on the follow-up and remediation action items. There be no other questions or comments. The meeting on the Committee of Audit is adjourned.
Thank you very much, Trustee Garcia. Trustee Morales, will you please convene the Committee on University and Faculty Personnel?
Thank you, Chair Monville. The Committee on University and Faculty Personnel is called to order. Today's consent agenda consists of the minutes from the May 20th, 2015 meeting. Are there any objections to the approval of the consent agenda? Hearing none, the consent agenda is approved. Today we have three speakers who wish to address the committee. And you have 2 minutes each. It's Lillian Tyes, Andrew Merrifield, and Susan Meisenhilder. Will you proceed in that order? Thank you.
Good morning. The report in support of executive salary increases should be titled Pity the Poor Presidents. When it comes to salaries, say the report, they are the, quote, last in line and undercompensated because they did not get the $80 increase full-time faculty received in 2013-14. The truth is that since 2004, the average pay for CSU presidents increased 44%, while the average pay for faculty increased only 8% in the same period. But presidents, we are told, are underpaid in comparison to other shockingly overpaid executives, many of whom have significantly greater responsibilities across the country. There is a model we should chase as a public institution, comparing our already highly paid execs to those who are even more obscenely paid across the country, while faculty and staff languish in this high cost of living state. It is also not lost on us that a 2% pay increase for a president earning in excess of $400,000 equals $8,000, while a 2% raise for a faculty member earning $40,000 is $800. Don't kid yourself, there's no similarity here. We're struck that this administration is continuing the legacy of the past with its excessive concern for the most highly paid employees in the system. There is a disturbing trend of misplaced priorities here. Even as the economy improves and people in the trenches struggle to make ends meet, they're being told once again to suck it up and take what's being offered. At the same time, there is excessive fretting about men and women who earn 3 to 10 times and more what we do. None of this will be lost on the 25,000 faculty who are working hard this summer to feed their families and prepare for the fall. We hear their anger every day. Without a fair resolution, we can assure you that you will be hearing much more from them in the days to come.
My name is Andy Merrifield. I'm a political science professor at Sonoma State University. And when I first became a regular member of the faculty about a quarter of a century ago, the president of my institution earned slightly less than 3 times as much money as I did. Now, the president of my institution earns about 4 times as much as a new faculty member, plus a healthy car and housing allowance. And so, as a longtime professor of public administration, looking at this trend, I do what I've often done in the 30 plus years or so I've been teaching public administration. I look to great theorists of public administration and complex organizations, and I come back to who I think is probably the greatest observer of complex organizations in the United States, Mark Twain. And Mark Twain would look at, two quotes came to mind, but the quote that Mark Twain had about God, because that might sound insulting. Instead, I'll just rely on what Mark Twain's observation about human beings, especially in complex organizations, was. And as we think about thinking that the presidents need money, whereas the faculty can get by on far less in actual dollars, Mark Twain once observed that human beings are the only animals that blush or need to.
My name is Susan Meisenhelder, and I'm a retired CSU faculty member who's watched and actually experienced the faculty situation for 45 years now. As you might imagine, over those years, there have been many recessions, tons of budget cuts, and other hard times that have fallen on the CSU and on faculty. But I've never seen the situation of CSU faculty as dire as it is today. It's dire in economic terms. It's dire in terms of working conditions, including benefits and workload. And it's very dire in terms of morale. You don't need me to tell you this. Many of these details about the faculty situation were spelled out in the four race to the bottom papers that CFA released recently. Today's agenda item of this committee, however, makes me wonder if anyone read those papers. In those papers, faculty are telling you their situation in both data terms and in personal story terms. Your response today is to once again bemoan the plight of executives. After the eye-popping increases of the last decade in executive compensation, and after the stunning decreases in the purchasing power of faculty salaries over the last decade, it's shameful. The message you're sending faculty is that you simply don't respond to data or to heart-rending personal stories. If I were a current faculty member on campus, I would be wondering what you do respond to. As a matter of fact, I wonder that not being on a campus. To me, as a retired faculty member, it's sad and infuriating that you're sending such a message of profound disrespect to faculty, to staff, and to the students they work with. Thank you.
Thank you all for your comments. And now for item two, I want to turn it over to Vice Chancellor Lamb to present the item. Item one.
This is agenda item number one, so thank you, Trustee Morales. Today I'm updating members of the board on the 2015-16 compensation pool for management personnel plan and confidential employee groups. These are the two principal employee groups that are not represented by unions. Effective July 1, 2015, many of our represented employee groups will receive general salary increases in the amount of 2% as part of collective bargaining agreements that you have already approved. Three of our represented groups are in the process of negotiations over compensation. The chancellor and this board have committed to a 2% compensation pool, both in our collective bargaining agreements. This process is simply part of implementing the board's approved budget that was fully funded by the governor. As such, for 2015-16, Chancellor White is implementing a 2% compensation pool for eligible management personnel plan and confidential employees effective July 1, 2015. As the purpose of this item is to inform you of Chancellor White's decision, that concludes my presentation and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Any questions? Okay, we'll move then to item two. This is an action item on executive compensation. Chancellor White will begin, followed by Trustee Garcia and then Chair Monville. Chancellor White.
Thank you, Trustee Morales. I am now making recommendations for board approval of compensation for the 23 campus presidents, three executive vice chancellors, and two vice chancellors. The recommendation regarding the vice chancellor for internal audit will come from the chair of the committee on audit. I know that you share my belief that recruiting and retaining high quality leadership, faculty, and staff for the CSU is important in both the short and long-term health of our enterprise and is critical to the overall success of our students and our system. I recommend a 2% compensation increase for these executives effective July 1st, 2015. 2% is the same increase that you authorized for all of our employees. And many contracts, as you know, have been settled with this 2% increase, and I have implemented 2% for the other unrepresented employees. As you know, we are currently negotiating with our faculty and some staff unions on this topic. To implement these increases signals our commitment to continue to work on salary challenges that have existed for many years. It is an ongoing process. We'll provide more information on general compensation challenges that we must begin to address in a strategic fashion. Like last year, I further recommend application of the 2% across the board for all executives. And where necessary, we implement this 2% increase with respect to the executive's total compensation, state salary, and any supplemental compensation paid from the campus foundation. The total 2% increase will be paid solely on general funds. To do otherwise would mean that the president did not receive a 2% increase. In addition, to ask the foundations to contribute at this point, because the presidents sit on the boards of those foundations, presents a conflict of interest. Let me also point out that there is a computational correction to the tables found on page 4 and page 5 of the board materials. You have a separate copy located at your desk. Members of the board, I'm asking for your authorization to implement increases for our system executives as outlined in the meeting materials as amended. Trustee Morales, that concludes my report.
Thank you, Chancellor White. Now I turn this matter over to Trustee Garcia.
Thank you, Trustee Morales. On behalf of the Committee of Audit, I would also recommend a 2% compensation increase for Vice Chancellor and Chief Audit Officer Larry Mandel. It is important from our view that Vice Chancellor Mandel be compensated in the same manner as any other system executives. Members of the board, I ask for your approval of the salary increase for Vice Chancellor Mandel. Trustee Morales, that concludes my report.
Thank you, Trustee Garcia. I'll now turn this matter over to Chair Monville.
Thank you, Trustee Morales. I've come before this committee to recommend a compensation increase for Chancellor White. I as well recommend a 2% increase of Chancellor White's total compensation based upon Tim's strong leadership of the system overall over the last year and to keep in line with virtually all of the other employee groups as noted earlier in the report. Members of the board, I ask for your approval of this salary increase for Chancellor White. Trustee Morales, that concludes my report.
So item two compensation for executives, and it's an action item before the Committee on University and Faculty Personnel. Only members of the committee may vote at this time. May I have a motion to approve? Second. Is there a discussion? Yes.
So I looked at the charts on pages 4 and 5 of our materials, and I understand that there may be some modification based on what the chancellor just said, but I did a very rough calculation and there are no totals on here, but it seems to me that the total dollar value of the increase to the vice chancellors and the presidents would be less than $200,000. Does that sound about right?
Yeah, the total increase, Trustee Eisen, is $187,299.
Thank you.
And on the supplemental compensation for those to whom that applies, mm-hmm. the state dollars involved are $4,395.
Thank you.
Yes.
I just want to raise a concern that one of the first actions that we're taking right after receiving approval for our budget is salary increases for executives. Well, when we submitted the budget to the state, we had certain categories in there. Salary increases for faculty, executive management is only one segment, $65 million. But we also had another component there about enrollment growth. And we haven't come out publicly to talk about impaction and how that impacts the number of students that we said we're going to enroll, 12,000 students. I think that we're also going to take action on that and not solely on the salary increase of management.
Other comments? No more comments? Okay, so on the motion then, is there a motion? Is there a move the motion? Okay, right. So
Trustee Morales? Committee.
Yes.
I'm sorry, if I may just for the record respond to Trustee Abreu's comments. You're absolutely correct in the sense that the budget that was developed by this board back in November of last year and ultimately funded by the legislature and signed by the governor of California, included a variety of categories. Included in those categories, as my memory serves me correctly, was a 2% compensation pool for all of our employees. It also included enrollment growth of around a little over 10,000 FTES, about 12,000 students in way of headcount. It included investments in IT. It included investments in our capital projects and deferred maintenance. And it included other things that my memory just doesn't bring right back up. I will say that since the budget came to us a few weeks ago, our staff and Steve Relier and Lauren Blanchard's office have worked hard to make sure that the allocations of the resources in terms of admissions for new students and transfer students from community colleges absolutely comports with the expectations of the budget that we brought to the trustees and was ultimately fully funded by the governor and the legislature. So I don't know if it's a report will be today, but certainly in September, we will identify precisely how we've made those allocations. The presidents have their allocations in front of them now in a penultimate form, and within the next week or two, we will be finalizing those budget distributions, which reflects student growth on each campus, but also reflects about $20 million being invested in student success, because as you well know, the issue for us is to get more degrees to a high quality degree in a shorter amount of time. And depending upon the student's preparation, et cetera, and the major they're in, sometimes it takes a little extra resource to get them sooner rather than later. And so I think the board will be pleased to know how we've comported our activities with the intent of the trustees. Thank you.
Just quickly, if I could add, Vice Chancellor Relly, I think in my read of the in finance governmental affairs, I think we're going to dive into those issues in some substance, but if we could make sure to tackle some of Trustee Abrego's questions during your report in that regard, because I think they're relative to the 15-16 budget, I think that would be helpful, and I want to make sure they're addressed.
Yes, we'll absolutely do that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any more discussion on this item? Okay, will all those in favor please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? The motion passes. On item three, the chair is asked to introduce the next item. Chair Monville.
Thank you, Trustee Morales, for allowing me to begin this important discussion for this board. Item number three is an informational item providing an overview of compensation for all employees in this system. I requested this item because we need to begin the conversation now, even if we do not have solutions today. Year after year, our human resources and our bargaining units are doing the best they can to negotiate within the parameters of available funding. As trustees, we have an obligation as fiduciaries and as policymakers to begin asking whether the funding available is sufficient to ensure that we can serve students with the appropriate quality to meet the needs of California's future. As you all know, education is a very people-intensive enterprise. We rely on the quality of people to provide quality education. Said another way, the only way to have a world-class university is to hire and to retain world-class people. Without a doubt, we had an exciting year, and we can appropriately celebrate a strong budget. And of course, we have invested a significant portion of those new funds into our employees. But we must acknowledge that CSU salaries across the board continue to lag despite recent increases. In fact, we have fallen further behind. And we live in California, as we heard from the speakers earlier, which means we're contending with an even higher cost of living. Even within California, there are big differences between the communities surrounding and served by our various CSU campuses. The CSU must, therefore, have a compensation system that is moderate, measured, and fair. That is in the best interest of our people and in the best interests of the people of California. While I ask for this item, I know Chancellor White shares my concern for the people of this university. The Chancellor is asked to also say a few words. And then I believe he's going to give the mic to Vice Chancellor of Human Resources, Lori Lamb. Chancellor.
Thank you, Chair Monville. For decades, I've seen the extraordinary work of our CSU faculty and staff, both as a student and as a graduate and as an education colleague, and now as your chancellor for the last 2.5 years. As I look to see all our faculty here today and our staff that are here today and all of those that you represent, My appreciation of the work that you do has only deepened over the past 2.5 years. I've seen your dedication. I've seen your sacrifice. And Lou is right. We must speak openly and honestly about what we know, which is that CSU employees are not making what their colleagues in other institutions and industries are making, even though our people absolutely put in the same level of skill and effort, if not more. Lou also spoke earlier about why this is important. Dedication to the mission has carried the CSU this far, but we face an increasingly steep hill in recruitment and retention for all our employees. At some point, dedication to mission can no longer overcome gravity or overcome economics. I appreciate the work of Vice Chancellor Lamb and her staff in closing some of these knowledge gaps. Yet, I also ask that we consider this information for what it is, a start and a promise. A promise to think deeply about these matters and create a framework to further address these issues. With that, I'll turn to Vice Chancellor Lamb to review the data we have. Lori?
Thank you, Chancellor White and Chair Monville. I'm pleased to provide an initial overview of compensation issues within our system. For clarity, when we talk about compensation, we're talking broadly about salaries, wages, and benefits. It's everything we pay to support our employees. We're talking about compensation versus talking about just salaries as we move through the presentation. Next slide. We begin with some of the overarching challenges. First, there is no single market that we can use to compare salaries and benefits for all of our employees. For example, for faculty, we must compare to other similar higher education institutions, four-year comprehensive master's degree institutions. For our IT professionals, we must compare with not only higher education, but the private sector, since that is our direct competition for these important employees. In addition, different types of analysis are required. Where we have meaningful comparisons, we can calculate averages or medians to determine our relative position. Where we do not have direct comparisons, we may have to conduct more sophisticated statistical analyses. In addition, the scope of responsibilities varies widely across comparison institutions. An example is that here our Executive Vice Chancellor and CFO is also responsible for overseeing information technology. In many other institutions, the CIO is in a separate unit. We cannot compare those two positions equally. Another of our specific challenges is the variation among our own campuses. What is special and unique about each one makes it more of a challenge to draw accurate comparisons. Size and mission are all unique. Another challenge that we face is that we have not completed a robust total compensation study that will look not only at salaries, but also at health benefits, retirement, and more. This will be done in the coming year and will further help us with our work in this area. Finally, as has been mentioned a couple of times, the geographic differences across our system create significant challenges. The cost of living in California is a challenge overall since it's one of the highest in the nation. But that is further complicated by the fact that even within California, there are significant cost of living differences between urban areas in the LA Basin, for example, and the rural areas in the San Joaquin Valley. Slide 3 refers to additional challenges that impact compensation. These are things that have or will take place that directly affect how we want to think about compensation moving forward. First, we are all aware of pension reform. When the reform was enacted, it limited the amount of pension benefits that can be paid out to an employee hired after January 1, 2013. This has the potential to impact our ability to recruit and possibly retain quality employees. In addition to this reform, there's the continued concern related to unfunded pension liabilities that the state of California faces. This is true for many organizations who have defined benefit plans like ours. Another challenge, which you will hear more about in a minute, is the rising cost of healthcare benefits. And finally, a significant challenge related to unfunded liabilities for retiree healthcare. This has become such a significant part of the budget in the state of California that we are all challenged to find ways to address it. These factors set the framework for what our challenge is, but I am confident that with adequate planning and preparation, we will continue to make progress. With these in mind, the following information will provide some additional context for how we might move forward in the future. Slide 4 is designed to demonstrate, as Chair Monville stated, that we are a people-intensive enterprise. This pie chart demonstrates that 41% of our overall expenditures in the system are for salaries and wages, 18% are spent on fringe benefits, which includes things like health care, retirement, employment taxes, and the like. In total, 59% of our total expenses relate to employees. The remaining 41% is for all other expenses, including interest, depreciation, supplies, information technology, building maintenance, repair, and more. These percentages that you see up here on the chart are very much in line with all other four-year institutions in the nation. We take this data straight out of IPEDS, the Interinstitutional Postsecondary Education Database, the National Repository for Higher Education Data. The average of all other four institutions is 61% for salary and benefits and 39% for other expenses, so we are roughly within the margins there. The numbers here for CSU that you see for this year, 2013, have stayed relatively constant over the last 4 years. The point of the slide is to highlight that as we consider changes in compensation, which includes increases in benefits, the money has to come from somewhere else. It's a zero-sum game absent new revenue sources that increases the overall pie. This presents us with a fine balancing act when considering what, if any, changes to make to our compensation strategy moving forward. This balancing act is increasingly complex as we look at the rising cost of healthcare benefits. Slide 5 is a chart that shows over the last 5 years how healthcare costs have increased and the corresponding costs to the system. These increased costs are paid by the CSU and not by employees. Thus, in 2011, healthcare costs increased 10.2% and cost $36.4 million. In 2012, healthcare costs went up 4.3% and cost $15 million, and so on. These increases are additive, so that over the 5 years, there has been roughly a 30% increase in healthcare costs, with an overall impact of approximately $111 million to the system. We also just received the projections for 2016, and the healthcare costs are expected to increase 7 to 11%, depending upon the plan the employee selects. Again, these costs will be paid by the CSU. So going back to the pie chart on slide 4, we can expect the slice for healthcare benefits to grow, regardless of the decisions we make about compensation going forward. Slide 6 demonstrates how we spend our compensation dollars across employee groups. As you can see, 49% is spent on faculty, 38% is spent on staff, 12.5% on management, and 0.3% on executives. This provides some perspective on where we are investing our compensation dollars. Slide 7 provides you some basic information on what it costs to move each of these employee groups by 1%. For faculty, it will cost $16 million. For staff, $12.6 million. For management, $4 million. And for executives, $100,000. The total to move our employee compensation pool by only 1% is $32.8 million. These are not insignificant numbers and also help explain why it's difficult to make progress in this area. Further to the issue of progress, slide 8 shows the across-the-board increases in base salaries, not in total compensation, in the CSU for all employee groups since 2008-2009. Across the top of the charts are the years, and on the side are the names of all of our employee groups. As you can see, for 5 years, no increases were implemented as a result of the economic crisis. Starting in 2013, all employees except executives received 1.34% or $80 a month. In 2014, most employees received a 3% increase, and this year it is budgeted and approved that virtually all employees will receive a 2% increase. These are the historical facts that then enable us to compare to other relevant markets. Slide 9 shows us these comparisons. This is a chart that shows comparisons of base year salary increases from year to year, so it is additive as you move through the years. The left shows the percentages, and along the bottom shows the years. The markets that are used for this purpose include the education market is the blue line. It includes all education, higher education, K-12, private and public. Unfortunately, there's no data source just for higher education that we can use for this purpose. And I will also note the blue line starts at 2009 because 2008 data was not available. The local market, or the orange line, is the Los Angeles area. This is certainly not local for all of our campuses, but it's illustrative of generally what's happening in the markets. The national market, the green line, is all employers. And the CSU pool represents the amount of our base salary increases, and that's the purple line on the bottom. This data comes from a reliable data source through the World at Work surveys that are produced nationally. However, as with much of this work, these are not absolutely perfect comparisons, but they are informative in that the trend is clear. We started behind the markets and we're getting further behind the markets. The gap is widening each year, with the exception of 2014, when the CSU had generally 3% increases and other markets had generally a 2.5% increase. As we look further at how we compare to relevant markets, we also compared various employee groups. Slide 10 shows summary information on base salaries. These again are not perfect and represent averages of where our employee groups are relative to comparers. Within those employee groups, there are differences. Each employee group also has its own unique comparators. So for faculty, we use a different set of data than we might for others. We use it from IPEDS and the AAUP, which is the American Association of University Professors, regarding comparison institutions based on size and similarity of mission, our four-year master's degrees institutions across the nation. As an average, our faculty are minus 1.75%, but this is not the whole story. This average is for our tenure track and tenured faculty only. It does not include our lecturers. Some tenure track tenured faculty groups are 14 or 15% behind, and some are comparable or slightly above. This data is also prior to implementation of our faculty equity program. This slide represents that but for a few of our groups, we are behind and often significantly behind our comparators. Another example is our police officers, who compared to other law enforcement in California are an average of 35% behind the market. Trends that emerge in this data are clear as well. For example, longer serving employees, like our full professors, are further behind the market than recently hired employees or newly hired faculty. Salary compression and inversion are common after going through an economic crisis like we did. In addition, employees at our larger campuses are often further behind than those at our smaller campuses. These data should cause us to think about our continued ability to recruit and retain a quality workforce to serve our students. They should also cause us to think about appropriate interventions that might help. Slide 11 highlights some of those interventions, including one, the faculty salary equity program that is underway, which is expected to invest $14 million at a minimum in faculty salaries. We have a staff equity program. It's not an equity program, but it's an in-range progression program that is in place, which is expected to invest $4 million, and the general equity programs that are available for managers and confidential employees. The only group where programs are not currently underway are the executives. These programs, as outlined here, will certainly help, but I think you can see from this data that it will not be enough to address the complex challenges we face in this area. So we need some future plans. We need a path to fulfill Tim's promise to you to think deeply about these matters and create a framework to further address these issues. Slide 12 outlines some of our future plans, and we're open to other things you might suggest as well. Plans include validating our work and conducting a total compensation study this year so we have better data. We need to look broadly at compensation and other issues surrounding retirement plans, retiree health care cost increases, and more. This is not a simple problem, and there will be no simple answers. We will continue to develop comprehensive analyses that will help us plan for making needed changes. And finally, we need to look close at our compensation policies to help set the framework for an appropriate strategy going forward that serves the needs of all of our employees in the system. These are actions and plans we hope to bring to the board in future meetings. That concludes my presentation, and I'm happy to answer any questions that may arise.
Questions?
Chancellor White and Vice Chancellor Lamb, thank you both for your reports.
Chair Monville, this concludes the meeting of the Committee on University and Faculty Personnel.
Any of my colleagues have questions before we moved off? I thought I saw some hands.
Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. Mr. Fagan?
So, yes, thank you. Lori, question for you. This was all very helpful, very informative. What do we have a sense of a timeline? I know you said when you started your remarks that you were looking at this with a projection of, you know, within this next year, you would be looking at this deeply. In terms of some of these plans, again, I know we're not talking implementation, but just in terms of things to reflect on for the board to consider, what's your timing on that?
Thank you, Trustee Garcia. We do plan to bring additional information analysis back to the board in September, and as well about your budget for the coming year. So I would expect for sure to be talking about board meetings further as we implement plans according to your directions.
Trustee Fagan?
Lori, quick comment and a quick question. One is just raising the issue of comparing salaries to other markets. I just wonder if that is a good construct to determine salary levels on. It's an accepted way, but you know, as we go about trying to figure out efficiencies and fairness, is it really the most appropriate? So I have no answer, but just would like to raise that question. I know Dr. Taze brought it up in vis-a-vis the presidents, and I think the legitimate question could be asking that same question, extending it throughout the system, not in a way to restrict salary compensation, but rather to look at equitable answers. The governor has, I think I'm accurately quoting him, expressed concern about academic arms races. And we raise ours, so they raise theirs. They say, look at us. And then we look at them, and it has no end. So I don't know if there's any examination or effort or even questioning to wonder whether that's an appropriate way to determine fair salaries. That's just a little idle speculation, but not meant to be completely dismissed. And the other question was on the health increases. We've had a couple years of 3% and 2%, but you mentioned we're coming back up to 7 or 8. What's the reason for the increase?
Let me see if I can address your first comment briefly so that I'm not dismissing it, and then I'll try to address the healthcare cost. The first comment is the using the comparable markets is an important best practice, but it is not the only way that you think about compensation, which is why we talked at the beginning of this presentation about what is the total budget of the CSU, and if you expand compensation, where do you take it from? Because the primary feature of a good compensation strategy is relevant markets combined with living within your means. There is not an unlimited supply of funds. So you can't just use markets and say we're going to enter the arms race and go there because it may not be practical or reasonable within our budgeted resources. So it's not the only thing, but it's an important element. As to the healthcare cost increases, it's always hard to say exactly what causes them to rise in any given year. Most often, it is just an experience factor and a usage factor, depending upon employee usage, employee experience, how many claims there were that year. We're in a self-insured fund as part of CalPERS, that those rates are largely driven on the experience factor. The other reality is that we have very comprehensive healthcare coverage, depending upon the options that you provide, that you select either from preferred providers or an HMO. They are, for lack of a better term, above market type benefits, the cream of the crop type of benefits, and they are expensive. And as people use those benefits, the costs are going to continue to climb. In even with all the changes in healthcare expenses over all of the years, that is not going to touch sort of these higher benefit plans like ours. I don't know if that helps a lot, but it's always based upon experience and claims. People are getting sick. Maybe they're having catastrophic illnesses more frequently. They're using their insurance, and that causes the rates to go up.
Other questions?
Well, I mean, first and foremost, I really want to commend you, Vice Chancellor Lamb, and the Chancellor for undertaking, and the Chair of the Board, for undertaking this effort to start thinking about compensation in a more sophisticated way than we have in the past. I mean, there's no doubt that the recession, you know, threw a giant monkey wrench into what was otherwise, you know, an equitable system, and now we have to try to figure out the best way forward. I noticed that your chart that compares us with, quote, the market is based solely on base salary and doesn't take into account benefits, which I think is an important point because, as you said, the compensation package is salary plus benefits, and to the extent that our benefits are in excess of the market, you know, that's something to consider when we are looking at this whole picture. I agree with Trustee Fagan that, you know, comparing us with others is, you know, maybe a way to look at it, but it's a complicated way for an institution such as ours. I mean, the security officers are a good example. You know, what happens on a campus in terms of security and what happens, you know, on the streets of San Francisco are, you know, totally different kinds of activities. So I don't know whether those comparisons are apt or not. So, but I do commend the effort to try to get a lot more sort of analytics and sophistication applied to the process so that we can all feel confident that we're doing the best job we can in terms of fairness. Thanks.
Other comments? Yes.
Thank you, too, for the report. I think it's extremely important to have a roadmap with precise milestones. Each of us trustees have been speaking to that, and you know, the goal of retaining the talent we want and need and recruiting the talent we want and need is daunting. Suggest, I'm sure our chancellor and our president have been vigorously informing the legislative leadership of our overall needs in our case for more general fund money, but I think it would be helpful to brief the Senate Higher Ed Committee and the Assembly Higher Ed Committee and Department of Finance with the fact that we are putting together a strategic plan, we're getting numbers, we're looking at where we are positioned in the marketplace as a serious challenge. Informing them early and keeping them up to speed as we go forward, I think, would be very helpful.
Trustee Garcia.
Thank you. Lori, one other thing, as we look to that you'll be doing, we talked about this a couple of meetings back, but where we identified the conflict of interest that's inherent in the funding from the foundations for president salaries, I would appreciate it if you could also come back and have that be an area of focus in terms of how can we address or resolve that inherent conflict.
We will do that in future conversations on compensation policies. Thank you.
Other questions?
I just wanted to share with Superintendent Torx. I appreciate that advice. Thank you. I think we did contemplate part of the reason for the timing. As I noted before, while it's difficult on the heels of such a robust budget, this board needs to begin now, ourselves, but I think with our legislative partners and our friends in the Department of Finance, because we do have some pressing issues that long term, you know, it's the elephant in the room that we've got to address. And so I appreciate that advice, and I know it's something that the Chancellor and I plan to spend some time in the fall doing. And so I appreciate that good counsel. And I also want to take a moment to thank everyone for their insights on this important issue, and thank Trustee Morales for allowing me to kind of jump in on this item. So thank you.
Chair Monville, this concludes the meeting of the Committee on University and Faculty Personnel.
Thank you, Trustee Morales. We're now going to, I'm trying to get the meeting here back in order from our meeting, kind of jumping around this morning, so this will be the last item, then we'll get back into order. I'm going to call to order now the committee on the whole. We now need to consider adding an agenda item related to executive compensation for the newly appointed interim president at San Jose State University. As you know, both the need and the decision to appoint this individual arose after the July 10th deadline for posting this item pursuant to the requirements under the Bagley-Keene Act. In order to add this item to the board's agenda, there must first be a determination by at least two-thirds vote of the board that there exists a need to take immediate action, and that the need for this action came to the attention of the board after the agenda was posted 10 days prior to the meeting. Prior to entertaining such a motion, I'd like to ask Chancellor White to please comment on when the need for this agenda item arose and why the action for this meeting is necessary.
Thank you, Chair Monville. As you know, President Kayomi publicly announced his resignation from the position of president of San Jose State University on the 13th of July. That same day, I met with campus leadership and faculty to hear their desired attributes for a possible interim president. Following those meetings, I asked Dr. Susan Martin to take on the interim leadership role and was able to announce her appointment on July 15th, which was after the 10-day agenda notice deadline prior to this meeting. This item and salary before you today could not be afforded the regular 10-day public posting due to the timing of President Kayomi's decision and announcement and the subsequent required steps to secure an agreement with Dr. Martin to serve as the interim president on this item today, so that the arrangement with Dr. Martin can be finalized and she can prepare to take on her very important role. Failure to act today would mean her status would not be finalized until the board meets again in September, after she will have already begun her CSU service. Therefore, today I bring forward an item that would establish the salary for an interim president at San Jose State University, an item which, due to its urgency, has received 5 days of public notice, exceeding the 48 hours required by the Bagley-Keene Act under these circumstances.
Thank you, Chancellor. Are there any questions, members of the board, on that? Seeing none, may I have a motion that is the board's determination there exists a need to take immediate action on this matter and that the need of this action came to the attention of the board after the agenda was posted on July 21st?
So moved.
I have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Again, any further discussion or questions? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? It's in the opinion of the chair that we have reached the two-thirds threshold to approve that item, to add this item to the agenda. Chancellor White.
Misspeak. It was not posted on July 21st, but it was posted for the July 21st meeting. Just a point of order.
Okay. Chancellor White, we did reach the two-thirds threshold, and so I'll defer the item to you to introduce the item.
Monville. I'm very pleased that Susan Martin has agreed to serve as the interim president of San Jose State University. She will begin serving as interim president following the departure of President Kayomi in the middle of August. Sue served as the president of Eastern Michigan University from 2008 until just a few weeks ago. Prior to her tenure as president, Sue was the provost and vice chancellor of academic affairs at the University of Michigan, Dearborn. She also spent 18 years at Grand Valley State University, where she was a professor, department chair, program administrator, assistant and associate vice president for academic affairs, and the executive associate vice president of academic affairs. In addition to her extensive higher education experience, Dr. Martin brings impressive public sector leadership experience to San Jose. She worked for many years in the Michigan state government as the assistant auditor general, and was appointed by two governors to serve as the deputy state treasurer for local governments and the commissioner of revenue. Sue holds a bachelor's degree in public speaking from Central Michigan University and an MBA and PhD in accounting from Michigan State University. I am very confident that her leadership, her experience, and her knowledge of public higher education will be a tremendous asset in the interim period. Today, I am recommending an annual salary of $346,000. This is the same state-supported salary as President Kayomi. She will live in the university-provided housing and be provided a vehicle allowance of $1,000 per month in lieu of a university-provided vehicle. Relocation benefits coming and departing from this interim assignment will be provided for in accordance with policy. I want to thank Sue, who is here with us today. Sue, where are you? Right there. And welcome her. Thank her for her willingness to provide stable leadership to our oldest campus during this time of transition. Chair Monville, that concludes my presentation.
Thank you, Chancellor. May I have a motion to approve the compensation? We have a motion and a second. Is there a second? Did I hear a second? I heard a motion. There's a motion and a second. Any questions? Trustee Eisen?
Yeah, I had a question. I think you said, Chancellor, 340-something, and on the chart that is page 4 of our prior committee meeting, it had a slightly different number, and I'm sure there's an explanation, but I just wanted to be sure we were being accurate.
The compensation for President Kayomi had a state-supported portion to it, the base pay, and a supplement from the Tower. With respect to interim president designee Martin, we have taken the base support salary but not included the foundation supplement, and we've incremented it from the 2014-15 salary of President Kayomi in anticipation of a 2% increase by this board, and that gets you to $346,000 and some change.
Any further questions? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Welcome, Dr. Mark, and thank you again for your willingness to serve, and we look forward to working with you, so thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, that concludes the committee on the whole. I will now ask Trustee Norton if you would please convene the Committee on Capital Planning, Buildings, and Grounds.
Should I start again? Good morning again. We have a, would any trustee wish to remove item 1, the amendment of the capital outlay program, from today's consent agenda for separate consideration?
This has to do with the Fullerton and Sacramento.
Pardon?
The Fullerton and Sacramento pieces.
Yeah, I kind of wanted to the fourth one. I asked the administrator this full explanation on the use of the success fees for that funding.
All right. So you would like to remove it from the consent calendar? Okay. Today's consent agenda consists of the minutes of the May 19, 2015 meeting. Is there any objection to the approval of the minutes of that meeting? If not, the minutes stand approved. Item 1 consists of board approval for the amended 2015-16 capital outlay program for the California State University Fullerton and California State University Sacramento. It's my understanding that Trustee Fagan would like to have some additional information with regard to the item pertaining to the Fullerton project. Perhaps President
Yes,
Garcia.
Trustee. Thank you, Trustee Fagan. I know I think he's speaking about our lights in the fields, and so I'll tell you a little bit about how that went through with the Student Success Initiative. The Student Fee Advisory Committee, that's comprised mostly of students, requested that one of the first projects of the SSI fees be the installation of lights on the North Fields. These fields are used for academic classes, intramurals, club sports, intercollegiate athletics, and of course, student events. Student wants the fields to be usable in the evenings. We are honoring the request by moving the project expeditiously. The ASI student leadership also has requested this item, and our Student Success Initiative website, in the spirit of transformation and transparency, puts it on our website on success.fullerton.edu. This provides progress on all SSI fees to all students. And also through this dashboard, they could actually monitor what is happening for every item that has been approved. Further, all the Student Success Initiatives have been communicated to students by posters hung by student leaderships that state your student fee at work. So the students see where the student fees are actually being used and monitored. Any questions that they may have can either go through the website or through our student leadership or through that student fee advisory committee. Trustee Fagan, does that answer your question?
It does indeed. Thank you very much. President Garcia, the reason I asked to get that brief explanation is it was, I think, the only one on the agenda today that talked about using some success fee monies for one of these projects. And I just want to keep emphasizing the need for transparency and clarity in how these fees are used, and that we may be continuing to ask for those explanations as time goes on.
Thank you, Trustee Fagan. I will tell you, our students also want that transparency and keeps us really on our toes. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Any other questions for President Garcia? Then I have a question for Council. Do we now treat both items as an action item, both Sacramento and Fullerton?
Well, to be honest with you, technically, Trustee Fagan is not on this committee, I don't believe, and so he wouldn't be removing it from the consent agenda. So it's still on your consent agenda. You can do it that way, or you can consider it separately. Either way, both is fine.
Okay.
I got my question.
Well, with all due respect to Trustee Fagan, we'll move on to the discussion item then, which is going to be presented by Executive.
Wait.
You still need to have a consent agenda item approved.
Oh, sorry. Separate from the approval of the minutes?
Yes.
Oh, right.
Because you didn't, only because your motion was only to approve.
Right. Okay. So may we have a motion then approving this item as a part of the committee's consent agenda?
So moved.
Is there a second? All in favors?
Aye.
Good. Thank you. Thank you for helping me negotiate these treacherous waters. Now, the discussion item to be presented by Executive Vice Chancellor and Chief Financial Officer Steve Relier will introduce the item on the approval of the schematic plans for the California State University Northridge and San Diego State University. Steve?
Thank you, Trustee Norton. This item requests board approval of schematic plans for two projects that the board had previously approved. The first project is the Sustainability Center for Cal State Northridge. To provide context to the board, this project was approved by the board in November of 2014 for amendment into the 2014-2015 capital outlay program. Today, the board is being asked to review and approve the schematic plans for the project. The other project is the Engineering and Interdisciplinary Sciences Complex for San Diego State University. This project was last brought to the board in May of 2015 for amendment into the 2014-15 capital outlay program and for bond financing, and both actions were approved by the board. Today, the board is being asked to consider approval of the schematic plans for this project as well. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to the presentation over to President Harrison to introduce the first project at Cal State Northridge.
Thank you. CSUN has established sustainability as one of our seven campus planning priorities. Our focus on sustainability achieves cost savings, fosters responsible stewardship of the university's physical resources, and most importantly, prepares knowledgeable graduates who will be leaders in sustaining the Earth's resources for future generations. The proposed new facility will provide a permanent home for both the Associated Students Recycling Center and the Institute for Sustainability. The facility will highlight and promote model sustainability practices and collaboration between the two groups, including student projects focused on the campus as a living lab, Earth Fair, America Recycles Day, and Recycle Mania. Since 1990, the Associated Students Recycling Center has recycled over 8 million pounds of materials, including cans, bottles, papers, cardboard, and electronic waste. The center employs approximately 12 students, works in partnership with campus facilities, and manages educational programs on waste diversion. Founded in 2009, the mission of CSUN's Institute for Sustainability is to promote and develop research and university programs related to sustainability. Board approval is requested to construct a new facility to co-locate the two programs and provide offices and meeting space in order to foster collaboration and better support the mutual goal of promoting environmental stewardship. I will now turn to Assistant Vice Chancellor Bai San Wan, who will present the technical aspects of this project. Bai.
Thank you, President Harrison. This slide shows the physical master plan for CSU Northridge. The proposed location for the Sustainability Center is across from Building 16, Redwood Hall, that houses the physical education functions, and it is adjacent to the Plaza del Sol Performance Hall. The green arrow depicts the vantage point of the picture and rendering used in the next two slides. This is the project site, which currently includes the Associated Students Recycling Center in the small fenced-in area and the adjoining vacant lot. The Plaza del Sol Performance Hall and its loading dock are seen here in the background. The project will improve the space for the recycling center and add adjacent office and meeting space. This is the rendered view of the proposed sustainability center. The building is designed with transparent office and meeting areas and high performance window systems that maximize daylighting. Roof overhangs will reduce direct solar heat gain. The building transitions in height from the office area into the area of recycling operations in order to provide high base space for equipment and recycled materials. The center will promote a number of sustainable design features, including photovoltaic panels, increased insulation, and efficient water, lighting, and HVAC systems. The building is being designed and constructed to be able to demonstrate sustainable practices. The second project for board consideration is the Engineering and Interdisciplinary Sciences Complex at San Diego State University. As Executive Vice Chancellor Relier mentioned, the project was amended into the capital outlay program and approved for bond financing at the May 2015. Hirschman will introduce the project.
Thank you, Vi. Excuse me, I want to begin by thanking the board for your approval of our capital outlay plan, as well as your approval of the financing. Since the last board meeting, we've begun demolition of two outdated buildings. And today we present the schematic design for our new engineering and interdisciplinary sciences complex. I want to thank colleagues in the Chancellor's office, our Vice President for Business and Financial Affairs, Tom McCarron, and our university architect, Bob Schultz, who is here with us today, for their spirit of innovation. This complex will transform disciplinary sciences on our campus. In engineering, state-of-the-art teaching labs will increase enrollment and pedagogical innovation. In sciences and engineering, interdisciplinary programs will bring state-of-the-art knowledge to our students. The project will also create substantial cost efficiencies. And last, by creating a quadrangle for the STEM areas, the project will tie the STEM areas to the historic core of our campus. I want to close by thanking donors such as Kevin Mayer, Executive Vice President of Disney Corporation, Diane Denkler, the first woman to receive an engineering degree from SDSU, William Leonard and Symer Corporation, each who have recently made seven-figure donations to the complex. All have, sight unseen, pledged funding to support our efforts. Most notably, I want to thank the Day family and Trustee Adam Day, who are leading the fundraising for the Thomas Day Quadrangle that will be the centerpiece of our new complex. Thank you for your support of this critical project. Bye.
Thank you, President Hirschman. Next slide, please. And what? Thank you. This is the physical master plan for San Diego State University. The board approved the site for the building at the May 2015 meeting. This is a better view of the proposed site as outlined in red. The project is nestled between the existing engineering building to the north, physical sciences to the west, and physics to the south. It is a large and challenging site due to the 16-foot grade change from the south wing to the north wing, but the design is successful in improving accessible pathways and creating usable exterior space for gatherings and special events. This is a view of the existing industrial technology and engineering lab buildings, which are being demolished and may be demolished, as President Hirschman mentioned. In the background to the right is the engineering building, which will be connected to the new North Wing building. This is a view of the complex depicting the building from the same vantage point with the engineering building to the right. The project design will be consistent with the campus architectural vocabulary with the use of stucco and red tile roofing. Staff recommends approval of these two projects. Chair Norton, that concludes our presentation. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Are there questions with regard to the projects at either Northridge or San Diego? Trustee Eisen.
Well, I want to commend both presidents on these two projects. They are incredible. I'm interested, you know, we passed our sustainability policy back in whenever it was, about a year ago. And one of the elements of that policy was that we not only make the effort ourselves to do all we could towards sustainability, but that we ask when we go out and engage third parties as vendors to check on whether those vendors themselves are engaged fully in the effort to have sustainable practices. And I would assume for both of these projects that when we go out and hire architects and contractors, et cetera, that we've done some due diligence to make ourselves comfortable that they are supportive as well of our sustainability policy and efforts. Is that an accurate assumption? I hope so.
Yeah, it's usually the campus will include those sustainability approach from the design professionals and the construction team as part of their selection criteria for the project, especially the sustainability center. That was very important.
Well, and maybe we're saying the same thing, but I know that when we design these buildings, we're asking that the architects and the contractors, you know, use concepts and principles so that they're LEED certified, et cetera. But the entities themselves that we are contracting with, presumably they themselves have sustainability policies and practices that we have, you know, taken a quick look at to be sure that we're comfortable that they're sort of aligned with us on those kinds of, is that what you're saying, Vi?
I believe yeah. They do, but I will look to Bob Schultz with San Diego State and Ken Rosenthal if there are any particular things from their design or construction firms that they looked at for selection of those teams.
Yeah, for the EIS complex at San Diego State, sustainability of the facility as a whole and the approach to taken was very much a part of the evaluation process when we selected Clark and AC Martin as the design build team. AC Martin in particular has a strong commitment to advanced sustainability for all their projects. So it's kind of deep into the core of their thought process for how they do business and how they design buildings for other entities as well as the university. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure if that answers your question or not.
It does in part. I mean, obviously, if we're going to contract with somebody to create a LEED certified building for us, we want to be sure that they do, in fact, do that and are good at doing that. But I think the intent of our sustainability policy was slightly different. Let's say we're contracting for something other than, you know, construction or architect we're contracting for food services or something else. We were hoping to expand our support of sustainable practices by being sure, and maybe this is something, President Harrison, that your Sustainability Institute is thinking about and looking at, but expand our reach by asking not only that we commit to sustainable practices at our institution, but that our third-party vendors are committed as well with respect to their own organizations, not as opposed to the particular project we've hired them for. So I just want to remind folks who are, you know, looking at that kind of stuff that that is the commitment we made as part of our sustainability policy. So thanks.
Could I ask Ken to just comment on that? I think you'll find that, yes, we're doing that.
So in choosing the director for center, it was very, and the architect, it was very experience in building sustainable buildings, but they have a robust in terms of how they treat sustainability. That we chose was Gilbane. They not only had previously done a net zero project, but they also a materials sorting facility recycling center, and had just finished a project of that type. So, and they were additionally able to diversion that they do.
Yeah.
Yes. If I'm trying to, and it could be that maybe expectations on sustainability party relationships, the party, so on the to who we will engage going forward across all vendors, not that we would be looking at those who have reputation are in fact committed to sustainability in the way we've defined it in our policy, so that we're aligning ourselves with we're actually delivering on that. Vendor selection process, I guess, would be the way to look at it today. So if we could get that clarified.
I would added specific pre-qualified. And we also, our general contractors, that is an element of the pre-qualification. So it's done on the campus. Typically can address it as part of design and construction team pre-qualification. We have not done that at this point.
And I really appreciate that response. And obviously you're focused on construction and architectural service impact campus. But, you know, and maybe this is sort of a broader topic for another committee, but I think what Trustee Garcia is saying is that third party, regardless of what they are vending, we as part of our process. So, and maybe that office would be working on maybe general counsel occur, so.
Right, I'm happy to get together with our interim of contracts and procurement, Melody Kojima, to add it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Could I just add, without or making us, and I think if you look at the products, the actual appliances, for example, composting toilets, reusing a material for the siding of the building that looks like wood, but in fact is made from remnants of cement, lifespan. The companies and vendors that we are engaged with involved heavily in sustainability. They don't sell these products without being so heavily.
Any, Germanville?
Oh, I was just going to add, Trustee Eisen, that we're in a more general context. We'll be looking at all and contracts from the
terms of the vendor's commitment to sustainability, not just construction and planning.
And I can't wait to that both of these are constructed.
Based on my discussion with council, although not legally required, I'd like to recuse myself on the item due to the project at San Diego State.
Thank you.
Move staff recommendation.
So we have a motion to approve the schemic plans for the California State University Northridge and the San Diego State University. Committee and only committee members may vote at this time. We have had a motion. Is there a second? Any further discussion? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Those opposed? Abstentions? One. The meeting of the committee.
Thank you, Trustee Norton. Would now ask Trustee Fagan, will you please relations and finance?
Governmental relations and I call to order. We've called a joint collective agenda items, provide information on two related issues, budget advocacy and outcomes. On today's agenda, we have two information items. The first one, bills and legislation of interest to advocacy efforts. Assistant Vice Chancellor Karen Zamaripa will be presenting the item. And by the way, she's not including all the bills. She's watching. There are hundreds of them. Only for us, she's only going to limit it concerning ones. So Karen, please present your.
Thank you. Sorry, he caught me off guard. Good afternoon. The legislature began last month. When lawmakers return to the state capitol, we will move at a very fast pace toward adjournment. In the CSU-sponsored bill, Assembly Bill 819, which deals with alumni affinity programs, was signed into law last week. Alumni associations now have permanent authority to offer affinity programs to their members. The other CSU-sponsored bill, SB 462, which supports the Green Music Center at Sonoma State University, has been approved by the Senate and Policy Committee on July 8th. Will return in mid-August, and it will be heard in Fiscal Committee and then off to the floor and to the governor's desk. Other notable legislation from our written report, want to call out, let's start with AB 967 and AB 968, which deal with campus sexual assault prevention and response. We are pleased to support SB, the Senate Education of AB 967, which outlines a common for sexual assault disciplinary proceeding. We're now supporting that measure. And the CSU continues to support AB 968, which considers policy in suspension or expulsion included on a student's transcript for as long as the prohibition is in place. Two measures dealing with Senate Bill 3 and AB 970 through their houses of origin. Senate Bill 3 would increase the state's minimum wage to $13, an additional cost of just over $36 million to the system. The CSU has not taken an official position on this measure, but we have communicated its impact to the bill author and to the fiscal committee. Assembly Bill 970 expands the role of the state regarding local living wage ordinances. We've been successful with clarification as it relates to the impact on the CSU and other state entities. And while we're still working on language, we are confident that we will be able to resolve concern about whether a local ordinance is the state minimum wage law.
Finally, SB 40, new California Post-Secondary Education Commission, has been substantially amended and would now create a higher education entity within the governor's office. Given the significant impact of the position on that measure. Chair Fagan, before moving to the budget report, I'm happy to respond to questions about you or the committee or board members are interested in.
Karen, just a brief update, if we can, on AB 1000 with regard to the student fees.
Sure. Assembly Bill 1000, which is being carried by Dr. State of the Senate Education Committee with to a fiscal committee where I expect to take it and it will move to the governor's desk. Just a reminder to put your student success fee policy in statute. Never choose to choose your policy in any way, shape, or form, you'd have to go back to Sacramento to get it changed in the code. Yes, sir.
Is that still the case?
That's correct. We still oppose the bill. Respect for the role of you as a board institution and but should remain in your hands as the governing body of the university.
Is anybody listening?
There are some people listening. I think the person that we primarily have to talk to is Governor Brown.
Thank you.
Moving to the budget.
Great. So we have a PowerPoint. Moving to the budget, the California State University, with the help of the legislature and ultimately the support of Governor Brown, received full funding of the board's budget request, a first in nearly a decade, and the end goal of a campaign now known as Stand with CSU. Next slide. This campaign was a continuation of efforts that really began more than 18 months ago, building on efforts to educate campuses and creating multi-level relationships. Last year, we were able to get augmentations to the budget, but those are not included in the final budget. Going into this year, we knew we needed to from our current advocates and add new ones that could help ensure the CSU was a top priority. I want to highlight of our efforts. Campus presidents and their teams and members of the advocacy and state relations began the conversations early and often with candidates for elective office. Second, for legislators not on committee, CSU Impact Day highlighted faculty, students, and alumni in key industries, hospitality and tourism, agriculture and water, and small business development. People's understanding of our contribution. Third, as the CSU provides the state's diverse population, we made great strides this year in building support and Latino and Asian and Pacific Islander caucuses. Building from this foundation, we held biweekly plan CSSA, CSU EU, and CSU. As with any campaign, we needed to give our advocates specific things to do and give our supporters a way to help. Our first move to achieve these objectives were letters to the Senate and Assembly leadership urging support for our budget. Out of 120 members, of which more than 70 were brand new to the legislature, signed the letters. Members then received the Stand with CSU lapel pins and wrapped with their Stand with you a move. Next slide. From there, we needed to keep the message alive and growing so that no one could forget what we needed. This slide shows message front of mind. We communicated on a regular basis to thousands of advocates, educating them about system and campus issues and making them aware and asking them to urge their legislators to support us, while thanking them also for their support along the way. Campuses and CSU in particular worked hard to keep the call for action alive and building. CSU was a regular presence in Sacramento. Beyond the three impact days, we also had two system-wide advocacy events, and Chancellor White advocated on foot, online, and on the phone. Next slide. Media this year. Blog posts and regular press releases were continually making our case, which informed the pieces being produced by reporters and opinion writers. We were sending daily tweets about the CSU and asking our friends and supporters to retweet. At one point, hashtag StandWithCSU was the trending topic in Sacramento for 8 hours, with more than 2 million impressions on Twitter. No message. In the final 2 weeks of budget negotiations, we made one more push that surpassed our expectations. The fourth was the day we asked all members of the legislature to wear the Stand with CSU red socks. Members were not only standing with us, but they took our message and ran with it. Next slide. This was a lot of fun, but more importantly, it helped bring our supporters and advocates together to make our case, while focusing our message and efforts to get results. We gave Speaker Atkins and Pro Tem Kevin DeLeon the support they needed within their respective houses to make the CSU a priority. In conclusion, I want to acknowledge an amazing team, especially CSSA's Chief Governmental Officer Meredith Turner and the student leaders of CSSA, with our student trustees Kelsey and your predecessors, the staff of Academic Affairs, Business and Finance, and of course, Chancellor White, along with hard work and a great result. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Karen. Any questions? Chairman Monville.
I'm going to take a risk I don't often, and Karen, on behalf of all of my colleagues, express a heartfelt thank you for the work of you and the entire team. I also want to take a moment to acknowledge both our colleagues in the Alumni Council and as well our friends at the student, our labor partners, all of our campus presidents and their campus teams. I recognize that this took a tremendous team effort, and but it took leadership with a strong strategy, and it took everyone to buy in some of the disbursements the chancellor has been talking about that have been happening in recent days. And the other thing I will mention for the benefit probably of my colleagues, in all the years I've been going to Sacramento, and I don't mean to make light of my friends in the UC, but I'm going to for a second. Every time I go up there, I think I've always remarked to Karen, you know, I just met another member of the UC legislative and advocacy staff. I mean, like, how many people do they have up to? They have the legislature. And this just shows the powerful of a small army. If you work strategically and work together as a team, the results are pretty powerful. And Karen, I can't say enough thank you on behalf of all of us. Your astounding effort, so thank you.
Questions? Any other comments? We're going to hear from Ryan Storm here in a second, Assistant Vice Chancellor for Budget, continuing this discussion. But first, I'm extremely pleased that the state legislature and the governor have significant workforce and citizenry by fully funding the board's budget request. And I think all of us thank them for recognizing the remarkable work of this institution. And again, I'd like to join in and with Karen and everybody, thanking the students, staff, faculty, campus leadership, chancellor's office, the chancellor, and my fellow board members for a job well done in advocating for and securing this new funding for CSU. And of course, I'll chime in as well. Karen and her office has just been amazing in getting this accomplished. I think if you looked at that last slide, there was on the bottom right a picture of a Times headline that said soft touch wins hard cash. And it was a great, great story about the success of the CSU kind of doing it right in getting this done, and specifically singling out Chancellor White and Karen for their hard work. So thank you very much, and wow, I think we all are very impressed. So next item on the agenda is a report on this 2015-16 support budget from Assistant Vice Chancellor for Budget, Ryan Storm. Ryan?
Thank you, Trustee Fagan, and good afternoon, everyone. The purpose of this presentation is to provide information on the trustees' support budget request and the state's final budget decisions related to that request. I will also discuss other final state budget items that affect the CSU. This slide provides an overview of the cost components of the board-approved support budget request to the state for 2015-16. Over an eight-month period of proposals, counterproposals, compromises, and a final agreement, state leaders agreed to fully fund the state's share of the board's request. It has been nearly a decade since the state fully funded the board's budget request. The last time that occurred was in 2006-2007. You, the board, deserve a lot of credit for crafting a sound budget plan and for your advocacy for this plan in Sacramento. The excited and passionate reaction we heard from CSU stakeholders when the good news came out a month or so ago is at least partially due to the challenging fiscal circumstances that the CSU faced in the recent past. Quite frankly, it was a tough stretch. This chart shows several years' worth of general fund appropriations received from the state. It paints a picture of where our budget has been, where it is going with budgetary decisions made this year, and where it is potentially headed next year under the last year of the governor's multi-year funding plan for CSU. You have seen similar versions of this graphic before, and the purpose is to show that our best year was 2007-08, that we took significant cuts through 2011-12, and that we have been slowly recovering since then. This slide shows notable changes to the Budget Act affecting the CSU and one notable omission. The board will be hearing more and taking action on several of these topics in the coming months. The state provided a one-time appropriation of $25 million to address the CSU's most pressing deferred maintenance and infrastructure needs. This is in addition to the $25 million for academic facilities and infrastructure on the first slide. Included in the final state budget is an expectation that the CSU develop and implement the California Dream Loan Program. The loan program will provide undocumented CSU students the opportunity to finance portions of their educational costs with student loans. Currently, this group of students and their families cannot participate in federal student loan programs. The 2014 law intended a match of state and CSU funds to support the program. Chancellor's office staff are working through many of the programmatic and fiscal details for this program. The new College Preparation Partnership Pilot Program, lots of P's in the title of this product, will provide incentives to community college districts and CSU campuses to coordinate their efforts to provide student development instruction to incoming CSU students. The state budget directed $10 million to the California Community College's Chancellor's Office to coordinate this program. It is envisioned that five CSU campuses will participate in the program. The state would like to better understand the factors that influence graduation rates and time to degree at the CSU. Therefore, it is calling for a CSU study and report that investigates such factors as course availability, course of study, employment status, among other things. Lastly, the state budget once again requires the CSU to prepare and submit an academic sustainability plan. This multi-year fiscal and policy plan would establish annual goals for a number of student success performance measures and outline how the goals would be achieved. This year's plan will be due to the state in November. The notable omission from the state budget was a proposal that would have provided $25 million of one-time funds for a second year of the Awards for Innovation in Higher Education. The purpose of the program would have been to recognize CSU institutions that implement innovations that lead to more timely degree completion. Shows you what is coming up next on the budget. As you will recall from previous board meetings, the CSU has presented the state a proposal that would allow the CSU to invest its reserves in a broader array of investment options. Currently, the CSU is limited to investing in a narrow class of fixed income securities, which significantly limits investment returns and, in turn, limits our opportunity to invest those returns in our academic facilities and our infrastructure needs. Chancellor's office staff have had many productive meetings in Sacramento on this topic. While the proposal was not included in the final Budget Act package, there is a commitment by state leadership to continue to work on this issue with the hope that this important change can be made later this summer. In budget proposals by the governor and legislature, CSU campuses were poised to receive $35 million of one-time cap and trade funding for energy efficiency and clean energy projects. In early June, state leaders decided to separate final budget decisions from the final cap and trade funding decisions. It still appears likely that the governor and legislature will provide $35 million of funding to the CSU. However, a final decision is not expected until later this summer. And lastly, the budget cycle begins anew at the very next board meeting. In September, staff will provide the board with a preliminary support budget plan for the 2016-17 fiscal year, and staff will solicit ideas and feedback from you, the board. That feedback will be used to craft the final support budget plan in November. So in conclusion, when the good news about this support budget broke a month ago, and since then, we have seen some truly remarkable reactions from CSU students, stakeholders, and supporters. The common threads of those reactions are excitement and joy and satisfaction, and really what it boils down to for so many is an unequivocal passion for this institution and what it represents. It is a time to be thankful and to celebrate the opportunity we have to significantly invest in CSU students, staff, and faculty via the funding priorities you saw during this presentation. Trustee Fagan, this concludes my report, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Great. Thank you, Ryan, and thank you for all your work on this. Any questions, comments? Becky?
Ryan, I don't think I just heard one last piece that you said about the cap and trade funding, which I gather was separated out from the rest. Did you say that there is a possibility still of getting, I just didn't hear the number, is it 35 million?
35 million, yes.
Great, thank you.
Any other questions? Okay, one thing I want to mention before we close the committee, and that is to welcome Kelsey Brewer as our new chair. And the reason I bring this up is it may be the first time that there's a student trustee in a leadership position on one of the committees. So I expect we're all happy about that and look forward to her good work and helping out and being here when I'm not. So
thanks, Doug.
Thank you very much. So anyhow, that concludes the work of the Joint Committee on Governmental Relations and Finance.
Thank you, Trustee Fagan. Trustee Garcia, will you please convene the Committee on Collective Bargaining?
Okay. Thank you, Chair Monville. Will the Committee on Collective Bargaining please come to order? Unless there are any objections, the minutes of the May 19th, 2015 meeting stand approved. We have two action items for you to consider in the open session. We will also hear public comments today before taking action on the items. Vice Chancellor Lori Lamb will present the items first. So with that, Ms. Lamb.
Thank you, Trustee Garcia. The first action item is the adoption of initial proposals for reopener contract negotiations with Bargaining Unit 13, English language program instructors at CSU Los Angeles, which is a CSUEU unit. This is a bargaining unit consisting of approximately 20 employees working exclusively within the self-support program at CSU Los Angeles. The collective bargaining agreement provides that the parties would reopen negotiations in this fiscal year on the limited issue of benefits. All other terms and conditions, including salary, have been previously negotiated until June of 2016. CSU is not proposing to make any changes to the current agreement, but we will commit to discuss in good faith any issues that the CSUEU brings to the table in respect of the benefits article. The second item is the adoption of initial proposals for what will be a new bargaining unit 14, located at CSU Monterey Bay. This is another group of English language program instructors that have recently elected to be represented by CSU EU. As this is a first contract, the parties will be negotiating all the normal provisions that one would expect to see covered in initial contract, in an initial contract, as outlined in both parties' initial proposals. The initial proposals for both of these are attached in the materials to the board. That concludes my presentation, Chair Garcia.
Thank you, Ms. Lamb. So after we have speakers, as I mentioned earlier, so after we hear from the speakers who wish to address the committee, we will take action on the matters before the committee. So I have a list here. I will read off three names at a time. Please note for the speakers presenting, 3 minutes for your remarks. And again, just in consideration of your fellow speakers, if we could stick to that, that would be great. So first I'd like to call Jennifer Egan, Molly Talcott, and Lois, I apologize, Belgarides.
Good afternoon. I'm Jennifer Egan, President of the California Faculty Association. At the May Board of Trustees meeting, Chancellor White, you mentioned 2 emails from faculty who thanked you for their salary increases in the first year of the contract. Well, CFA has received hundreds of emails from faculty addressed to you that are not as rosy in tone as yours were. They express frustration, disappointment, fear, and anger over management's reopener offer of 2%. We are getting the feeling that you haven't been reading our research. If you haven't read the faculty stories in our Race to the Bottom paper, Losing Ground and Losing Faith, we think you should. When faculty shared stories with us over email during the summer, we heard more of the same refrain. Faculty are hurting financially and they are angry. We keep trying to communicate the basic facts of the matter that you don't seem to hear. In good times and bad for the California state budget, faculty salaries remain flat. Our stagnant salaries are a matter of the budgetary choices and misplaced priorities of CSU management. Faculty need a significant across-the-board increase to remedy years of stagnation that predate the 2008 financial crisis. And we need regular SSIs to fix our broken salary system. CSU faculty know these facts and feel it in our own experience. We heard from faculty in all ranks about falling out of the middle class. An associate professor from Fullerton writes, "I would like to think that being an educator in the CSU doesn't mean having to give up on the American dream of being a homeowner and one day being able to enjoy retirement. At present, the CSU is making this a dream deferred." We also heard repeatedly from faculty members in teacher education programs. Their students are coming out of programs and getting K-12 teaching jobs, which is great. What's not so great is that the students with newly minted starting salaries above or near their professors with advanced degrees and years of experience in the field. It was surprising how many emails we got that talked about that. In pleading for empathy for lecturer faculty who shoulder so much of the teaching in the CSU system while making the least, a lecturer from Cal Poly Pomona writes, addressing Chancellor White, "Maybe guys like you are good guys who just need to see some of us so we're real to you rather than fictive. You can come to my house. I'll cook for you and you can ask me questions anytime." A professor from Dominguez Hills writes, "I remember that you said, measure what you value. The data published by your office shows that the CSU faculty salaries lag behind those of every other higher education system in the state. Additionally, over a 10-year span, management ranks and their salaries outpace that of faculty and the CSU system's operating budget. This strongly suggests that you value management more than faculty. We saved the emails for you and will send them to you in batches in the coming weeks so you can read them. But we have some faculty members here today who will share some representative samples with you. We're going to keep talking and giving voice to faculty until you listen to us. And if you'd like to have dinner with that lecturer from Pomona, we can probably help you arrange it. Thank you."
Good afternoon. I'm Michelle Barr at Cal State Fullerton and a member of the CFA bargaining team.
I'm here to contribute to the effort Jennifer Egan described. We are here once again to impress upon you just how incredibly cheated and demoralized the CSU faculty feel by the management's skewed priorities. Trustees, the CSU managers have lost our trust. The offer of a 2% salary is enormous, unfortunately, only in its symbolism. It confirms the accuracy of our feelings. We have been deprioritized and disrespected. The more value we contribute to the CSU, the lower our real salaries and our collective morale sink. We love our students, and we abhor the way the CSU takes advantage of our commitment to them by routinely underpaying us, no matter what the state budget does year to year. A full professor at San Marcos, who is also a parent, describes the profound erosion of the CSU system. I've been across the country visiting 3 CSU campuses and 12 non-CSU campuses with my 2 daughters as they choose colleges. It is clear the faculty are not valued in the CSU compared to the other institutions we visited. The CSU campus tours all talked extensively about how to deal with impaction and diminishing student-faculty interaction. These were never mentioned at the other state or non-state schools. As a CSU faculty member myself, I find the tours downright depressing compared to the other schools. A 2% raise just continues to degrade our system. Please show that you respect and value your faculty by trying to get our salaries back to a respectable range compared with similar institutions. And feelings aside, we simply cannot and will not afford to be cheated any longer. The CSU's ability to recruit and retain us is in jeopardy. A full professor at Sonoma State writes, "Next year, my department will hopefully hire a new tenure-track math professor. I'm worried that we won't be able to attract good people because you aren't supporting us with decent salaries." We suffered for almost 10 years. My department has lost 2 junior faculty to jobs with higher salaries. Will we be able to keep our only remaining junior faculty? I'm not sure. 2% is not enough. 5 is fair. It's what we need to be able to continue our jobs, educating the future of California. Existing faculty doubt they will stay in the CSU, given how poorly we are paid relative to our peers in the state and nationwide. An assistant professor writes, "Last fall, I moved cross-country to begin a tenure-track job at CSUN. Like many new faculty in the CSU system, I was trained by a top scholar in my field, have an active research agenda, and have an extensive and outstanding teaching record. I would like to stay and make my career here. I do not know if I can feasibly do so. I still have not been able to find a small apartment of my own to rent in the LA area that is affordable on my salary. The 1.6% GSI that CFA fought for only adds up to $40 a month after taxes. This is insignificant given the high cost of living in California. I would like to build my future here, but I'm discouraged. In other cases, faculty are planning their exit strategies or have already left. I could share hundreds of other stories with you, but instead, I implore you to read them with a healthy dose of both reason and empathy when CFA sends them your way. Squeezing faculty from all directions, less pay in real dollars, fewer of us on the tenure line, more FTE students while raising the salaries of already well-paid administrators is not a way to run a university system with students' best interests in mind. Faculty will continue to fight for a system that excels in both student success and in treating its educators with dignity, 2 achievements that are inextricable. 2 won't do, 5 is fair. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm sorry, was that Michelle Bart?
Yes.
Okay, because I had Molly Talcott as the second speaker. Is Molly here?
Yeah, she's going to be going forward. We have Lois next.
Okay, because I don't have that person. I'm sorry, I just didn't have Ms. Bart as a speaker for today. Okay, so let's just continue. Ms.